Welcome to the Defense and Aerospace Report. I'm Faga Maradian here at the Halifax International Security Forum in Nova Scotia, in Canada, one of the world's leading gatherings of defense, national security, economic, political, and intellectual leaders. And we're honored to have with us our very first guest at this year's Halifax Forum, Bessma Momani, who is a PhD professor at the University of Waterloo. And thanks so much for joining us.
Happy to be here.
A lot of stuff going on. We just got back from Dubai in the Middle East, and everybody is talking about Mohammed bin Salman and his revolution. Everybody is talking about the conundrum with Saudi, UAE, and Qatar. At the time, Hariri did the extraordinary trip to Riyadh, where he resigned. Now, I think you just told me that he's arriving in France, and then Hezbollah declared war on everybody, not to make the situation too easy. Talk to us about all of this churn, what it all means, what it means for the region, but equally importantly, what does it mean for allies of the region that are in an unusual position right now, where they're just sitting on the sidelines and watching all of this evolve?
Yeah, well, you know, you've really hit it on the head. It's a very exciting time, but a lot of uncertainty, and that's really the key message here. A lot of uncertainty. I think Mohammed bin Salman, MBS, is very brash. He clearly has a vision of a foreign policy that, frankly, in my opinion, doesn't think in terms of the long game, very much has a short-term perspective on things, and we see this already, whether it's, you know, picking a fight with the Qataris, having very high demands, 14 demands that, frankly, no sovereign state would accept, starting a war in Yemen that is very difficult to extract from, a great civilian and humanitarian crisis going on in that country, and of course, to add to his load, if you will, he's now basically intervening in domestic Lebanese politics, and as you said, putting pressure on Hariri to sort of, you know, really kind of make it more difficult for Hezbollah to function in the government. And I would say on that one, you know, most Lebanese have no love lost for Hezbollah. It's a militia group, a terrorist organization. But the reality is they have memories of a civil war. And that civil war haunts Lebanese people. And they don't want to see Hezbollah. If it's not in the government, it'll be outside of the government, causing basically, you know, wreaking havoc and a lot of the damage and destruction to the country. So it's a strategy that I think MBS fails to understand about Lebanese politics. And again, the sort of consistent pattern I see is starting things and not having an exit plan. And that's exactly where we are today.
You know, it's funny because there were so many people who look at him as a grand strategist, saying that if you look at the proportion of young people in the population who are really eager and demanding change, you know, a friend of mine was talking about, well, the kind of, you know, if you look at the art that young Saudi generation is producing, is both irreverent but very, you know, very Western, very different and out of the mold. And there are those who also say that, look, you know, the Saudi Arabia and a lot of the countries have tolerated exported an extreme version of Islam that you as a Jordanian or Jordanian descent, you know, wouldn't really recognize in a lot of ways. But talk to us about how this plays out, because what's going to be, where are we going to be even in a year, because each action has an opposite reaction. Israel is sitting on the sidelines, having allied itself now with the Emiratis and the Saudis in this alliance against Iran. Talk to us about how this plays out and what the repercussions are. And, you know, one question which I think everybody's asking is, at what point is there a coup against Mohammed bin Salman ultimately?
So two things. I'm glad you talked about youth, because I actually wrote a book on that. Something you didn't know, Vago, but I wrote a book called Arab Dawn, so please look that up. And absolutely, I think MBS is responding to enormous hunger in Saudi society. This is a vastly majority of society that's young. They're obviously connected. This is a society that's, you know, most consumers of YouTube, the highest percentage of YouTube consumption is in Saudi Arabia. The highest percentage of Twitter users is in Saudi Arabia. They're hungry for the outside world. They're increasingly educated, and I think far more cosmopolitan than we give them credit for. They don't want to live in Saudi Arabia. They want to live in a place like Dubai. And that's the reality. So I think that he's responding to enormous hunger for change among young people. And I would say that in terms of the social changes that he's implanting, fantastic. But his foreign policy, I think, is a whole other ballgame. And that's where I think I'm a little more worried as an analyst of what he's doing externally for his country. And of course, let's not forget, too, the sad part of this all is that there's a lot of young people who are, you know, basically loving this nationalist fervor that comes with war. It is a reality that there is a rallying around the flag effect that we're seeing in terms of Saudi Arabia and its youth. On the question of what does it mean regionally, I mean, this is the thing. The reality is that this is a region that has a lot of fault lines. We know that. I mean, that's just notorious of what the region is. But at the same time, I think what you can't have in your strategy is a short-sighted vision of, you know, I'm just going to pull Hariri out, for example, of the Lebanese government, and, you know, it's not going to cause all war, because they'll understand the value of Gulf money. Of course, Saudi Arabia is the largest injector of capital into the central bank. We have 300,000 Lebanese that work outside in the Gulf, and that's an important way of bringing hard currency back into the economies. You know, their workers' remittances are very valuable. So, you know, this was really kind of a, you know, a sort of a threat that he thought, you know, the Lebanese people would walk down from. But, you know, what I think he fails to understand is that, you know, where he plays checkers, the Iranians play chess. They're in this for the long game. It's a menace in the region, without a doubt. Iran is a menace. It's, you know, supported terrorist organizations and terrorist regimes like the Assad government, without a doubt. They have tentacles all over. But I think what MBS fails to understand is that, you know, in the case of the Iranians, they're willing to sacrifice a lot more than the Saudi young people are in the name of foreign, you know, gambles. And so his game needs to be, I think, farther into the long term. The question of the Israeli involvement, and this is where I think things get really complicated, of course, because we know Netanyahu, for example, in Israel already has a very weak government. He's riddled with corruption every day, you know. My inbox is filled with even more accusations against him and his wife and his associates. We know that Netanyahu, you know, coming from the right wing, loves conflict because it does have a rallying around the flag effect. And so even if his intelligence services tell him, as we've seen, that, you know, Iran is not an immediate threat, or that his intelligence tells him that it's not advisable to go into war into Lebanon, I'm afraid that you have that toxic mix where it's the perfect time for Netanyahu, but it's not necessarily the right time for Israel. And so that's where things can go wrong, and that's where war and conflict can, frankly, you know, easily be sparked, and that's the kind of thing that worries me.
If you look at that extraordinary picture of all the young people and MBS is in the corner, you know, circled in red, those are all the people that have been arrested who are from the other six families, right? The seven families on which the kingdom is based. How can you do that? Demote the religious police, which have an extraordinary role in Saudi society, and not have some repercussion. And then if that repercussion happens, what are the implications for Saudi Arabia? Because everybody says it's too big to fail. It is too big to fail. How likely is it? And then what happens if Saudi Arabia gets unhinged, which has been this, you know, pyramid of stability for a lot of reasons, because the wealth is always shared and everything has been done by consensus.
Yeah, and, you know, I share that sentiment. You know, this is really, I think, you know, a very delicate situation. Look, I think MBS is going on the impulse that he has 60 to 70% of the population who are young, under the age of 30, supporting him. And he probably does. I mean, I think that's a really important point here. They're hungry for reforms. They're fed up. They're bored. I mean, you know, one of the things I think is so fascinating about Saudi society is that there's no entertainment. There is no theaters. There is no bowling alleys. There is nothing to do but go into the desert and you know, take your car and do some tricks, you know.
Or watch a lot of YouTube, apparently.
Apparently watch a lot of YouTube. So, I mean, I think that there is a great deal of hunger for change. So, you know, he's emboldened by that. And I think that's a great thing. I mean, I think the reforms he's bringing socially are fantastic. But what he's failing to understand, though, one, is that, you know, he needs to bring economic investment into his country. And by rounding up some of his the very interlocutors, people like, you know, Walid bin Talal, who frankly brought some of the investors to that very important Saudi economic conference just a few weeks ago, are now going to say, wait a minute, I'm not going to put my money into Saudi Arabia. This place is unstable. So the challenge is that, you know, foreign investment are going to be scared away. This is right after these great, fantastic announcements of, you know, new automated cities, etc. That's really, I think, problematic. We're already seeing a capital outflow. We're seeing a stock exchange go down. There are a number of worrying economic fronts that happen. It's not to say that corruption needs to be tackled. It absolutely does. I mean, this is a really, I think, nepotism runs through. And his frustration with princely, you know, welfare state is absolutely understandable. I mean, there's just simply too big. You know, there's too many of that royal family. I think I've heard numbers from 6,000 to 10,000. And you just cannot have, even as wealthy as you are, to have that generous of a welfare policy, as well as corruption. You know, they're both go hand in hand that basically support all of these princes' ways. So I think it's important, but I think the way he did it, the sort of ambiguity of who was targeted, you know, it's not clear that they are the most corrupt of all of them. There's no due process. Clearly, the 11 that first got rounded up seemed to have more shock value than, being necessarily the most corrupt of all of them. One of them, Mit'ab, being, I think, more importantly, because he was the head of the National Guard. So again, that's the kinds of thing that, it's bold and great. People need and want to see boldness, but needs to be done in a way that looks orderly, that doesn't add more chaos, and frankly, really keeps, I think, investors and the economic engines of growth continuing to pump and grow.
Right. There was a funny joke going on that everybody had better behave themselves at the Ritz, otherwise they get moved to the Marriott. So I thought that was a very, very funny. No slight against Marriott hotels; they do a terrific job. If you were advising MBS had an opportunity to spend an audience with him, because I'm told that he likes to actually hear people who challenge his way of thinking, no matter how everything here has played. What would you advise him? What would be the top three things that you would tell him, hey boss, you're on the right track on this, but you're really wrong on this, and some specific policy actions he should take to make sure that ultimately he succeeds and his nation succeeds?
Well, one thing, the previous king, King Abdullah, I think did a great deal of investment in bringing human capital to Saudi Arabia. Sending out approximately 90,000 people to study abroad, just in the U.S. alone, half of which were women in the very end of the last few years of it. So there's a great deal of talent. I've met these young Saudis. They believe in meritocracy. They want to prove themselves. They're educated. Bring those in. Those are your people that you want to bring into the highest echelons of government in decision making. You need to root out corruption, I think, through both adding transparency, that's a really important part of it, and also showing that there's due process. I think people need to see that there's going to be due process, because tackling it is a great thing. But if it becomes nebulous and people don't know if it's because you're rising too fast, right? Or is it because you're the wrong cousin? Or is it because you invested in an area that MBS wants to invest in? All of that, it's all sounds, very problematic. And I think that's when you start to create fear and panic in a society. We see that in China. This is not what, MBS should have in terms of its strategy, where the Chinese government is increasingly cracking down on elite and they're moving their money out of that country as fast as they can. No one can afford for Saudi Arabia to fall. As you said, it's too big to fail.
I want to ask you about ISIS. There's been this sense of liberation that territory, that ISIS has been pushed out of some of these territories in Iraq as well as in Syria, especially in Iraq. But now we're seeing what the cost of it is. Utter and complete devastation. The Iraqi government's putting the estimate at $100 billion to try to repair, clearly a gambit to get the international community to partner and to pony up some of the money for that. Also, the sheer number of people who've been killed. There have been reports, there was the Time magazine report, but also the New York Times talking about the death toll of Iraqi civilians, even in this precision campaign that was being waged. Talk to us a little bit about what's the next step, because ISIS is a little bit like water. Wherever you push it out from one place, it has a tendency of surfacing elsewhere. It's franchised around the world, whether in the form of Boko Haram or elsewhere. Talk to us about what this campaign needs to look like if it's going to succeed and cause lasting change.
Yeah, and I would say that, look, the military aspect of this was necessary. This is not to say that you can't have a defeat of ISIS without really getting rid of their so-called caliphate and their claim to some sort of administrative authority. But you rightly pointed out that this is a challenge in terms of what after ISIS. And there is no plan. And that's what I think is really worrying. We had a very robust coalition to support the military defeat of ISIS, but there isn't that kind of robust international coalition today to rebuild affected areas. We're talking about Raqqa, which is completely destroyed. People don't have homes to go back to. Where is the Marshall Plan, so to speak, in terms of investing in places like Iraq and in Syria? And of course, we have complications here. One, Iraq is sitting on a huge reserve of oil. This is not Bangladesh. This is not a country that's poor in terms of resources. You're going to see a lot of countries that are going to say, wait a minute, we are not going to be contributing to an oil-rich country like Iraq. And there's some legitimacy to that point. Syria, obviously, that is still not unsettled. Effectively today, are you helping the Assad government and regain legitimacy and authority in those areas if you start rebuilding? Is it over, right? I mean, if we look at Palmyra, for example, we saw ISIS come back. So there's a number of challenges there. The reality there's IEDs everywhere is something that I think is troubling for the immediate term. This is something that is, as we know, children often face the greatest, casualty from IEDs. That's something that we need to do. We cannot just, I think, bomb ISIS from the skies and not talk about how to defeat defeat or how to defeat the ideology on the ground, and any sort of, I think, local resentment toward coalition forces creates the conditions for ISIS 2.0. So you need to invest in that. There's also a real challenge with education. I mean, in some of these areas like Mosul, they've 4 years under ISIS's education system. I mean, how horrific is that? There needs to be a deprogramming of young people there. There needs to be a reinvestment in schools. Back to the challenge here is who's going to contribute. There's no plans for a Marshall Plan, and more importantly, people see this rich oil country and they don't want to give. So we've got to put something together. I would point out that the last time there was a big meet for ISIS debt, Iraq debt restructuring was after the Gulf War, after the invasion of the Americans, and it was a really hard go to get people to commit to helping Iraq because of those factors. Corruption in Iraq is rampant, even though I think the government is really trying to keep things together. It's just a legacy of, so many factions in the country. Keeping it together with state welfare still seems to be a big issue. And that's all, I think, part of the great challenge here. In terms of, masticizing of ISIS, absolutely. We are seeing it in its own propaganda networks talk about how great it is in terms of its global reach. And, remember here, it's a franchise. It's not just the fact that Boko Haram was always Boko Haram. It became an ISIS affiliate because it was an opportune chance to basically become an affiliate. So we're going to see more of that. Obviously, the Philippines is one really that's really, I think, of great concern. You mentioned Boko Haram. This is really something that needs to be countered. It means investing in resiliency. It means investing in understanding local grievances, because sometimes there are local grievances in these places. We look at Ansar Bayt al-Maqdis, for example, in Sinai, that eventually became the Sinai affiliate of ISIS. Well, there was a local concern there, and that needs to be addressed before you start thinking about everything as being an ISIS ideology. And often cases, it's basically an opportune chance for these local organizations to latch on to a bigger entity. There is now a competition, sadly, amongst terror organizations, particularly al-Qaeda and ISIS, in terms of who is going to hold the mantle of the truest jihad organization. And that's obviously very troubling. We need to invest in, putting in the kinds of proper information about both Islam, and I think that involves sometimes even Salafist preachers to get in there to talk about, the true interpretation of Islam, to decode some of the, I think, propaganda that we see in ISIS. And let's not forget, there are far more Muslims, for example, that have been hurt by ISIS than any other religious group. They need to be able to come to the fore and expose the tyranny that ISIS brings. And that really, I think, involves, good sort of public information type tools. The Iraqi government is doing some of that already on Iraqi television. I've had a chance to see. That's really helpful, because I think it's a long-term game to basically root out this ideology.
And what about Bin Laden's son? I mean, there was this sense that once Bin Laden was killed, it would be all over. But there were even some folks then who said, well, listen, he's still got some kids out there who are as radical as their dad, if not more. How serious a threat is al-Qaeda that, some people have erected a tombstone over?
Well, I think that, look, this doesn't go away. The reality is it's a matter of size and scale. You're not going to eradicate al-Qaeda completely as much as we'd hope and wish we could do that. But what you can do is contain it. What you can do is lessen its scope. When we were at the point of having 50,000 people leave Western countries and parts of the Middle East to join ISIS, that's problematic. That is, an enormous, I think, stain on all of us. So that's the kind of thing that you want to do, is you want to contain it by, removing as much oxygen as you can. Money supply is really important. And remember here, everything from narcotics to smuggled antiquities to oil that made its way into various parts of Iraq, for example. All of that is a good way to basically stop this from growing, because there's many aspects to the growth of the terror organization. It's not just ideology. Some of it is, unfortunately, people looking for salaries and for trying to make their life a better one, and living under ISIS's accepting ISIS as an employer is a convenient way when you have 70% unemployment. So there's so much that needs to be done. And again, it's about investing in these societies, investing in re-education, and making sure that ISIS 2.0 doesn't have a chance to flourish.
And that's what General John Allen said at last year's forum, where he proposed that Marshall Plan. Bessma Momani, PhD from the University of Waterloo, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.